Well, good morning, everyone. I'm glad to be here and looking forward to talking with you. So my style is pretty much storytelling, and I will tell you the story of my career. And often I'm surprised at it myself, and I'll just, you know, kind of walk through that. But I have to warn you ahead of time, about 10 days ago I got sick for the first time, I think, in 5 years. All right, so I learned a lesson because I went on vacation. And my wife keeps wanting me to take more time off, and so we went to Florida, and about 2 days in, I got sick as a dog. I had the flu, I guess, or something, I don't know what. And so for most of the vacation, I was sitting on the couch or laying on the couch, and finally got home on Sunday, and took Monday off, and Tuesday. Went back to work Wednesday. And I told Melody, I said, see what happens? You take vacation, you get sick. So I need to just stay home and keep working, because I, you know, when I'm working, I'm fine. Everything works out just fine. But so if I have a coughing fit and I sound like a 100-year-old smoker, I apologize in advance. I think I'll make it through, but I'm feeling much better now. So look, I break things down. I don't really care how old the audience. This works for middle school kids, high school kids, college kids, and adults. Because I think too often we just go through life doing what we are taught to do, and what we think is probably safe. And very seldom do we step out possibly as far as we should. So I have a very simple philosophy, and that is to dream big. And I mean dream big, all right? So for everybody, that's gonna be a little different. And then work hard. There's nothing will replace hard work. And the third point is never quit. And as I go through the story of my time at Auntie Anne's, I'll point out where a couple of those points became very important. You know, I think I've had an entrepreneurial spirit since I was a kid, and I'll tell you why I think that. So I was born, I was an Amish kid, probably only till I was three or four. And I think fortunately for me, my dad decided he really wanted electric and he wanted to drive a car. Otherwise, I might still be riding in a horse and buggy somewhere. And that's okay, though. I think I was about 10 or 12. And you know how, I mean, there's these auctions, all right? Now this actually was pretty long ago, I guess. It would have been in the 70s. And tourists were relatively new to Lancaster County. They were coming. But I don't know if you ever saw that movie, Witness. Harrison Ford, and you know, as a little Amish kid, witnessed a murder, and that really launched Lancaster County as a tourist destination. That's not to say they weren't coming before, because one of our biggest advantages for business and tourism and all of that is that more than 30% of our nation's population lives within about 3 hours of here. And I'm going to be off by a couple miles or by a million people or two, but between Baltimore and New York and all of the populated areas, Philadelphia. We have a tremendous opportunity here because it's all within driving time. So as a little kid, I think I was about 10. We had some Amish neighbors, and we spent all the time together. I lived way out in the country. There were no other neighbors. And we realized these tourists were interested in anything Amish. And so we went into the neighbor's house, the mom of these kids I was with, and we took a whole bunch of quart jars. And they were jars, you know, that they would put away peaches and put away corn. So we went to the tap and we filled it with water. And we set up a little table out at the end of the driveway and we sold Amish water. And we sold out pretty quickly. It was good until she figured out we had sold all her quart jars. She wasn't too happy about that. But talk about a missed opportunity. That was before bottled water was a big thing. So I should have started a company at about 10 years old called Amish Water. I think we would have done pretty well. But a little bit of advice. Success requires a lot of fortitude. I think fortitude is possibly a lost art or a declining art. It simply means that you have strength of mind that enables you to overcome the challenges, the negativity that you will often face, enables you to bear pain. More than most. And so if I had any single thing I would encourage you to work on, it's work on fortitude. You know, when you get poked, between the eyes, get back up and go again. When you think something isn't fair, probably isn't, but don't worry about it. Just, you know, bear down and walk through it. Fortitude will be your greatest asset as you develop your career and go through your business life. My daughter, I think, has a pretty good handle on this. She's in her last semester as a senior at a school in North Carolina. And the other day, I was kind of excited because tuition's coming to an end for us, right? And she's like, oh, man, she's kind of bummed that it's coming to an end already. She can't believe how fast 4 years went. But I told her the same thing I'll tell you. And that is that the end of your formal education is really just the beginning. You know, your time in college and learning is really kind of just the price of entry anymore, you know? It'll position you well if you put it to work, but the end of your college experience is only the start of your journey. And there's lots of hard work about to come your way. I love work. I really do. I am more comfortable working than I am on vacation. I get bored very easily on vacation. So work is something, if you learn to enjoy it. For me, I was never an athlete. Okay, so we opened a sports complex, but I really don't have an athletic bone in my body. But, you know, the P&L for me is the score sheet. So at the end of the month, I know if we won or lost the game that month. So I think each of you will find your own way. Back in 1989, Ann and Jonas Beiler started Auntie Ann's. I'm always confused with Ann as her brother or her husband or something. Ann is actually my second cousin once removed on the Smucker side, not the Beiler. So even though we share a last name, our relationship was some distance. I think I have over 100 first cousins and a couple hundred second cousins. So when I was a kid, I mean, Ann knew who I was, and I kind of knew who she was, but we didn't really know each other. But this Auntie Ann's was starting up. It was 1989, and there was so much energy around that business. And I'll tell you, a lot of it was Ann's charismatic personality. She drew people in. She really started the business to help other people. Of course, she made a good living along the way, but her greatest interest was in helping people find their way and create an opportunity in business that would, you know, potentially change their lives, and clearly it did that. Melody and I bought a franchise in 1989. At that point, I think they were $3,000 for a franchise. We opened a concession unit, so it was a concession trailer like you would see at a fair, and we operated maybe 10 weeks out of the year. So we picked a couple in Maryland and here and there, and we found a couple in Florida that were pretty good in January. But you know, in the early days of Auntie Ann's, it was really almost a lifestyle business. The first 30 or 40 locations were all in farmers markets. And farmers markets were generally open Friday and Saturday, or Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And people were doing okay. They were making a good living. But more importantly, it fit into a lifestyle. And that's really what started it. But, you know, the interest in that business grew, and it's very simple why the interest in Auntie Ann's grew. And it didn't have anything to do with slick marketing. It didn't have anything to do with strong promises of financial performance of any kind. But what happened is business people started walking by these stores in farmers markets, and they saw a line of people waiting to buy pretzels. And if you're a business person, or if you're a salesperson, anytime you see a line of people with money in their hand, you know there's something going on. And that's really what launched the company in a pretty meaningful way, really, over time. Park City, not too far from here, was our first location. And I think we worked for about 2 years to get into that location. And the manager, Monty Senko, he was a manager of the mall, and back then, the mall manager did the leasing. You know, it was all pretty much self-contained at the mall. He just said, there's just no way you're going to make it in a mall with pretzels and lemonade. And I'm going to go back before, you know, I don't know if any of you go to the mall there, but way back in the day, where the Auntie Anne's is located, and the food court is located on that lower level. There was a roller skating rink, all right? So when a mall had nothing else to put in, they'd put a roller skating rink in. It was the worst location possible in the mall. Finally, he provided one, offered a location, and it was right near, well, it's exactly where it is now. But he was so sure it was going to fail that he only offered a 30-day lease. And so you're supposed to build out a store and on the, you know, with great risk because you've only got 30 days. And they renewed it, and they renewed it again, and that location went on to do very well. Most interestingly, Monty Senko became so confident in the concept that he moved to Atlanta, Georgia, and opened 5 stores himself. So, but that was the first mall store, and it was really the start of the business model as you know it today. So I had another business, but we did this concession trailer a number of times a year. And Auntie Anne's had a franchise convention, I think once a year. And so I attended and met someone named Ellie Ziemer. Ellie is a local person, and she was working with Ann and Jonas to really professionalize the office. And there was just a tremendous amount of pressure on growth. And, you know, we were opening stores, and at that point I wasn't involved in the corporate operation. I was just there as a franchisee. But a couple of months later, so I met Ellie at this meeting, and a couple of months later I get a call at home, and it was Ellie. And she wondered if I was interested in joining Auntie Anne's. And it was, I mean, it was kind of a strange call because I hadn't thought about becoming an employee there. And so Melody and I talked about it, and I thought, you know what, that might be a decent opportunity. We were making pretty good money as self-employed people. We sold outdoor lawn furniture and gazebos and storage barns. We had a location in Silver Spring, Maryland. That was our primary location. Of course, everything was manufactured up here in Lancaster County, and we'd ship it down, and things were going all right. But I decided to join Auntie Anne's, and I'll make this the first point, I guess. I took a pay cut to join the company. I took an entry-level position, probably earning about half of what we had been earning up until that point. And there's probably not a good logical reason to have done that, except for the energy around the company. And so as you're looking for what to do, look for energy. You know, if you want to be alive and you want a vibrant place to work, look for one that has energy. And that was really the start of a 21-year career at Auntie Anne's. You know, it was probably 5 or 6 or 8 years later when I was talking to Ellie, and I said, Ellie, why'd you call me? I mean, there were lots of people involved at Auntie Anne's, and lots of people would have been interested in working there. And I keep going back to the very simple things. She said, Sam, when I met you at the annual meeting, your eye contact and your handshake made an impression. And I didn't forget that when it was time to hire someone. This is oversimplifying it. But good eye contact and a strong handshake led to a career opportunity for me, the opportunity to purchase the company and continue to build it, and eventually to sell the company. So, you know, I think a lot of my success at Auntie Anne's came about as a result of what I refer to as adequate self-doubt. All right, it's really important to be confident. All right, so you should be confident in what you're learning and how you're going to apply it. But I had never done what we were doing at Auntie Anne's before, and I think adequate self-doubt is what kept me very interested in constantly learning from our franchisees, learning from our vendors, learning from everybody that I, you know, was really in contact with. And the difference between that and being so confident that I know everything, I believe is what created the most opportunity for me at Auntie Anne's over those years. So I started entry-level position, and basically the job was to visit all the stores that were more than 2 hours away, because there were people visiting the more local stores. And you know, so early in my marriage and with our first child, I was traveling about 1,000 miles a week. This was in 1992. There was no Southwest airline. There was no such thing as a $100 one-way ticket or something like that, and we simply couldn't afford to fly. And so I drove, and I would leave on a Monday, get home Friday afternoon, sometimes Friday night, depending on the route I was taking, and I loved it. I mean, I just loved it. It was a hard grind, but I was getting to know franchisees and getting to know their employees. And my role was really as a business consultant, so I would simply walk up to the store and see what I saw and make suggestions on, you know, how things might be able to improve, look at their product mix and, you know, all of those things that you're basically just trying to pick up a nickel or a dime per transaction. And when you have a couple thousand of those transactions, it adds up. And so I spent the first year working out of the office here in Pennsylvania. And then an opportunity came along to open a regional office in Florida. And so Melody and I moved to Florida in about 93, I guess, and we spent 3 years down there and opened about 100 stores over that period of time in all of the southeastern states. We were then asked to go to Chicago. There was a regional office, but it was struggling a bit. There were a good core group of employees there, but they needed some new leadership, and so I spent a year out there and eventually moved back to Pennsylvania and rejoined at the corporate office in the late 90s. All of this time, I was just going to work. I was working as hard as I could and doing everything I could to serve the franchisees. And a lot of what I did then, you know, wasn't that exciting if you just looked at it from the outside. But my encouragement to you is to always give everything you have, even if the job doesn't seem like that big a deal. And the reason is, as opportunities continued to be created at the corporate office, I now knew almost all of the franchisees in the Northeast. I had helped open more than 100 stores with franchisees in the Southeast. And in the course of a year, I had visited with every single franchisee in the Midwest. And they had a lot of confidence in me. And so as management positions were created, or opportunities came along, and they knew about the organization developing, they were calling in saying, hey, you should consider Sam for that position. I had a lot of support among our customers, and there's probably no more important place to build value in terms of what you're providing. So that career continued to develop, and eventually I was the president of the company, working for Ann and Jonas. And as I look back over my time working for them, I would say that probably the most important characteristic that I brought in terms of supporting them as a family and them as business owners was loyalty. And it was loyalty to Ann. Ann had a different way of going about business. And by different, I don't mean there was nothing wrong with it, but it was different than what you would find in a lot of businesses. And it was people first. She always put people first. And that often cost the company money. And there were times that people wanted to argue with Ann about the right step and the best move. But it always came down to people first. And for me, it was very simple. I wasn't being asked to do anything immoral. I wasn't being asked to do anything that wasn't ethical. This was the owner of the company I worked at and her preferred method of doing business. And I became very loyal to her and what she asked me to do, and that just created more opportunities. I think it was in the early 2000s that they went through a succession planning process as a family, And, you know, at the end of that process, they had two daughters, and neither were interested in owning or managing the company. Jonas and Ann were still, I mean, they weren't very old. I think they were approaching their mid to late 50s. But they were, I think, tiring, and really, I think, were coming to a point where they felt they were ready to sell. And I talked to Ann and Jonas one day, and I asked permission to make an offer to purchase the company. Of course, there were several conversations leading up to that, and they agreed to consider an offer. So I, you know, I basically asked, "How much do you want for it?" And there wasn't much negotiating because I wanted to respect what they had built, and so we came to an agreement, and we began to work on the funding side of things, trying to find a way to acquire the company. And you know, at the end of that, the number was pretty big, or at least for me it seemed pretty big. And but I made it easier because the there was a number at the front, and all of the rest were zeros. I figured, well, zeros are nothing, right? So what's the big deal? It's just this one number up front. And so we managed to pull it together. And so I think the, you know, one of the keys is, sorry, I'm going to sit down while I talk. You know, one of the keys was that, you know, this company, it was just pretzels and lemonade. But if you got inside of the company and looked at the internal management and the internal management controls, man, we knew almost every detail of what was happening. And so when we went to a bank, and they said, "Well, look, you know, talk to us about your financials," we pulled out a P&L that was at least an inch thick, and it covered every department, every region, and you know, we had at that point gotten very good at breaking down into incredible detail up to how many cheese dips were sold yesterday. This is a pretzel and lemonade organization, all right. But it gave the banks tremendous confidence. And our lead bank at that point was Bank of Lancaster County. Eventually, Bank of Lancaster County was acquired by PNC. And they worked with, I think it was four other banks or maybe five other banks to participate this loan and put together the package. I believe at that point it was the largest lending deal that they had ever put together. And you know, I'm just sitting at the table watching all this happen, thinking, "What in the world? I mean, how did I get to this point?" And it was an incredibly exciting time. But you know, to afford to create the ability to pay back this loan, we had to make a lot of changes. And those changes were in the franchise fee, our royalty. The royalty that was paid by the franchisees, and but you know, we applied a principle in our work with our franchisees that we applied throughout the company, and I basically called it participatory management. In that, you know, all important decisions, we wrote proposals, and we would propose the decision that we thought was the right decision. And we involved our franchisees in that process. And so literally when it came time to raise royalties, we wrote that as a proposal and went out to the franchise community and gathered feedback and made some adjustments based on their input. And I remember a franchise meeting in New York where we announced what we were doing, and they actually applauded a price increase. But it was more about the process. And so as you think, and you will invariably, you all are headed for management positions of some sort or another, think about that participatory process. And there's some great models out there. But if you allow people, if you encourage people, in fact, if you cause people to be involved in the decision-making process, what you're doing is taking most of the objections and dealing with them ahead of the decision, instead of just making a decision because you're so cocksure of what you know, and then having to clean all of it up afterward. I promise, any major decision you make, you will either do that work ahead of the decision or you will do that work after the decision. And it is almost always more productive to do it ahead of the decision. It feels like a lot more work, but you'll build a lot of strength in your decision-making process and a lot of support for your decision-making process. When we purchased the company, I didn't really think about selling the company. It wasn't the plan. I think I probably anticipated being there for, I don't know, rest of my life or at least a pretty long time. We made all these adjustments to the model, and no matter what business you're in, there's going to be challenges. And I would say that the pace of business today, the speed of business today, is faster than ever before. And a lot of that leads to more opportunities more quickly. But a lot of that also means that whatever model you're working under today could be gone tomorrow. And you have to be constantly working at understanding the model and making adjustments to how you go about doing business. And, you know, we got to a point 5 years or so into my ownership, and there were several things happening that, let's see if I can sketch this, but, all right, so in any retail business, net sale per customer is a big deal. So it means that every customer that comes up and you have a transaction, you know, how much are you selling them? You know, what's your sale to each customer? And if I look at net sale per customer, over the entire history of the company, that number kept going up. But one of our challenges was that the number of transactions at each store location was going down. And we were able to, you know, create small bumps, but overall, it was going the wrong direction. And some of those bumps were the pretzel dog, all right? So, you know, we took the pretzel and wrapped it around a Nathan's hot dog, and man, it's good. I don't even like hot dogs, and it's good. And, you know, new dips or, you know, cheese or cream cheese or whatever it was, but it was all around. Dutch ice was another great one. Actually, I had a much better. Have you ever had the Dutch ice? Basically a slushy, right? Remember it was Auntie Anne's? I wanted to call it antifreeze. Wouldn't that have been good? The lawyer said, no way, some kid will drink it, and then they'll go out to the garage and they'll drink antifreeze, and then we'll have a problem. And anyway, so. But, you know, through those product additions, we were able to keep the net sale per customer going up, even as the transactions went down. And so we're like, what's going on? Everybody loves the product. But see what happened between the early 90s and late 80s, early 90s, and the early 2000s is, if you go back into those late 80s, Park City and large malls similar to that, that was where you shopped. At that point, there were no Tanger outlets and Rockville outlets, and you pick all the lifestyle centers where there are now only five or six stores. But between the late 80s and the early 2000s, the number of square feet of retail space in the United States doubled. But the population of shoppers only increased at single digits per year. So basically, you took the same amount of shoppers and split them out into twice as much space. And that's why our transaction counts were going down. You know, there wasn't anything at the model level that we could do to fix that. Excuse me. That got me thinking about, okay, what are the next steps? And really, licensing the product, creating frozen products, you know, all of those things. That was the next step to protecting the, you know, the long-term health of the company. And based on my relationship with franchisees, basically I grew up with them, I knew the level of conflict that was going to cause, and it just wasn't something that I was willing to walk the company through, and that's what led us to finding a buyer. And we sold at a very respectable price, and probably the best timing possible. We were in the recession, so we sold in 2010. 2008 was the real estate bubble collapsed, and lending was just not available. Business performance nationwide was really, really struggling. And but through all of that, our growth continued. Stores, the net sale per customer held up. Transaction counts were still slipping, but we were still opening the same number of stores per year. And those stores were doing very well. Cash flow from the company was very strong. So you had a lot of private equity on the sidelines with cash, but not many good companies to buy. And so we were able to drive a multiple in the sale of the company that was, well, I didn't walk away from it. It was too good. And so I thought I was going to retire. We sold in November and went to Florida for a little while. Of course, we had young kids. They were still in school, so we couldn't just take off. And came back, you know, in the spring, temperatures warming up, thinking, okay, what am I going to do? And, you know, by June, I could hardly get out of bed in the morning. All right, now, this, you know, and so I'm thinking, who do I talk to about this? Because nobody's going to pity me. We had sold at a number that I didn't even dream big enough, all right? That's why I tell you, dream big. You have no idea what you can accomplish. And just too many of us, we keep our dreams safe. And you will miss out on some of the coolest stuff you can imagine if you just let yourself dream big. The risk of failure is high. All right, I didn't tell you about the three businesses I started almost out of high school that failed. At 21, I lost $40,000 on a real estate deal in Frederick, Maryland. It was every penny I had. The only thing I had left was a truck about the size of a UPS truck. I had to go out on dates in that thing. That's all I had. Dream big, man. The risk of failure is high, but who cares? All right, be careful with the people around you. You know, don't take stuff that doesn't belong to you. But dream big. So I'm like, I can't even get out of bed in the morning. It was the most ridiculous thing I ever experienced. I guess I was wrestling with depression, only I never thought didn't think of it like that. But I also realized that for me, accomplishing a goal is not where I get fulfillment. It's the pursuit of that goal. So, you know, as I look back on my career at Auntie Anne's, I had a new position every 2 years, either in a new city or a new level of responsibility. And I always had some goal that was probably just a little bit bigger than I should have set. And so I was just always going after that goal. And after I sold, I didn't have another goal. I just hadn't set one. I didn't think I needed to. I thought I was going to retire. And I will tell you, at 25 years old, Melody and I set a goal to be financially independent at 45 years old. And it wasn't necessarily so I could stop working. It was just that I wanted the choice. I wanted the choice of what we could do. We sold a few months after my 45th birthday. We were financially independent. So the last goal kind of that I had set was accomplished. And I think the reason I'm telling you all of this is that, trust me, it's the journey to where you want to be, not the arrival, that's going to create fulfillment in your life. Of course, being able to take vacation when you want is cool. You know, driving a newer car or whatever things are important to you, those are cool. But for me, it's the pursuit of a goal, not the accomplishment of one, that gets me up in the morning. And so that's how we got to a sports complex. I needed something to do, I guess. And we started out with the plan was like an 8 or a 10 court volleyball center. And I was committed to keeping it in Lancaster County because I believed it would be an economic driver. So you have these little tournaments, people come into town, they stay in hotel rooms, they eat at restaurants, they buy gasoline so they can drive back home, et cetera, and they go shopping at the malls or wherever. So I really wanted to keep it in Lancaster County. And so I was with my realtor, and we literally looked at 25 buildings. And 24 of them, the ceilings were too low, or the columns were too close. There was one that would have worked, but it was in New Holland. And I don't know if you know where New Holland is, but you can't get there from anywhere. It's just, you know, it's Route 23. So we decided that that wasn't the right one. And he kept telling me about this former Armstrong building, right off of 283. And I had gone to Harrisburg Airport, I don't know, hundreds of times over the 10 years prior. I never saw that building. It's 14 acres. It's 600,000 square feet. I don't know how I didn't see the building. I never saw it. And he kept telling me, let's go look at this building, you know? And I said, man, I didn't even want to see it. He gave me the listing. It was 600,000 square feet, 594. And you know, the price was huge. I mean, it was just huge. I needed about 60,000 for 10 hardwood courts. This thing was 600. Finally, we were out of buildings to look at, and so I decided, all right, we'll go look at it. And I walked in. There was the roof leaked like everywhere. There was just water on the floors. It had been empty for about 8 years. There were 5 tribes of raccoons living in there, and they were angry. They were angry when we came to visit, I'm telling you. And it had the old metal halide lights, so there's this yellow glow all through the building. But you know, I walked through the overhead door and looked, and I just looked, and it's just enormous. I mean, if you've been, it's big, you know. Imagine before there was anything in there. And I could hear whistles, and I saw kids. I mean, not for real, it was in my head, but. That started the process. So I think I skipped church that Sunday and went to Staples instead and bought this grid thing and laid out basketball courts and tennis courts. And Melody came home and said, uh-oh, because she knows when I get wrapped into something, you know, it's all over. And so we started looking at, is it possible? You know, there was no model to follow. There is no other sports complex of this size. And so we did market research as I know how to do it. And we started calling every athletic director at the high schools and the colleges. And we called the sports academies, whether it was soccer or volleyball or basketball, and just started trying to understand what's the market, you know, what's available. And you know, it got to the place where I thought, I'm not sure, but there's only one way to find out. And I still had pretty much money in my pocket at that point. It's all spent now, but we're coming along pretty well. And so we really launched the project with a little bit like Field of Dreams. You know, we said if we build it, they'll come, and they did. But I'll tell you, we had a lot to learn along the way. I realize now the advantage of something like the Auntie Anne's model is that someone opening a store today gets the experience of about 1,400 stores that have already been opened. And in this case, we learned a lot of lessons the hard way. And we figured out what works and what doesn't. And how long have you been around the area? I don't know. But 4 years ago, we got a fair amount of recognition in the newspaper, mostly about traffic and parking problems. And I spent the first year in the parking lot. It was crazy. We just had cars. So our consultants told us we needed 600 parking spaces, and we had them. We needed 2,000. And on our first couple of events, that first year, was just wild. So I put a cap on and pulled my collar up so nobody knew who I was, and I'd say, park here, you know, and spend all that time in the parking lot. But it was It was a great experience and quite a bonding experience with all of the employees. I'll also tell you, you never know who you're bumping into. Because our marketing guy, look, everybody was in the parking lots on those first couple of events. I don't care what you did. Our marketing guy was out there and he's trying to help people go. I'll call it a behavioral demographic. When we saw a New Jersey license plate, how many are from New Jersey? Oh boy, okay, I'm gonna be gentle, all right? But people from New Jersey don't wanna listen to traffic directions. So when they were coming, we knew we had it coming. One woman was so mad at him because he wouldn't let her park where she wanted to park. She said, you know, you'll never amount to more than a parking attendant. No wonder you're stuck out here. Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry, ma'am. But we learned a lot. We learned it pretty fast. And things are coming along pretty well. This year, on November about 14th, we had our 1 millionth person came through the building for this year, this calendar year. Our first 35 weekends of the year, 32 of them are large. A large weekend is when we have 7,000 people in the building per day. We have about 10 events that'll bring 10 or 11,000 people a day into the building. And the coolest part, I mean, obviously I want a business that succeeds. I'm not there as a nonprofit. But the coolest part is that in January, February, March, and April, almost every hotel within reach has 100% occupancy, at least on weekends. And a more normal would be 15 or 20% occupancy. And so the economic impact that, you know, we envisioned is happening. If you drive 283, you'll know, you know, one exit west, new hotel opened, five little restaurants. Right at our exit, there's another hotel has opened. There's two more planned to the east. So it's having the desired effect in terms of economic impact. We feel like our model is coming along really well. 2013 was, you know, we just opened. 2014 was a very, very difficult year. I'd say 15 stabilized, and last year we broke even, made a tiny bit of money. And I think the point there is fortitude. Fortitude, man. I have a great team. They took it on the chin when they had to, and they would come back every day and keep figuring out how to do it better. I mean, we literally, for that first 18 months, we would have an event every weekend, and the first thing we did on Monday morning was recap. On Tuesday, we planned out how we're going to do it better the next weekend. The next Monday, we went through the same exercise, and we were able to make some, you know, pretty significant improvements over a short period of time. We're looking at a second location in Ohio, probably about the same size, same model, and my CFO shakes his head and says, "I don't know how you roped me into this." As we're trying to put together the package to open out there, and I said, "Well," I said, "good luck, because I'm going to South Carolina next week to look at a third location." So we're, you know, I think there's a model, and I am most alive when I'm walking on the edge of risk, and I intend to stay alive for a pretty long time yet. So, I don't know if you heard anything that was interesting there or not, but that's kind of my story, and I'll be happy to answer questions or give you any responses I know how to provide. Yes?
My name's Brian. I'm a sophomore business student. I'm actually from Lancaster, so I can remember you opening it up and walking in there for the first time and being like, man, how is this going to work? Because it is. It's just so massive. And you can't really wrap your head around the demand. But my question is kind of different. You mentioned opening 100-plus stores in 3 years. That's just so much and so big. During that time, like, how many hours were you putting in? Like, what assistance did you get in doing that?
At Auntie Anne's, we did a pretty good job of departmentalizing as we developed these regional offices. But I will say that, you know, my work week back then for a period of 4 or 5 years was probably 70 hours a week, maybe 80. I drove 1,000 miles a week 4 out of 5 weeks. So, just that alone is a lot of hours. But I had my routes planned out so that I would spend non-productive time driving. That is, before a mall opened at 10. And then after the malls closed at 9, I'd try to get another couple hours in to get, you know, closer, you know, to the next location. So, and by the way, that was, I still use paper maps. You know, there wasn't Google Maps, and there was, this will date me, but, you know, my cell phone then, listen, was $3 a minute. So you didn't use a cell phone much. You know, it was only if you really, really had to. But I loved it. These people, the franchisees, you know, they were working hard. See, what happened in the early 90s and into the 90s was that corporations were eliminating middle management positions. And it was a tremendous opportunity for Auntie Anne's. And the reason it was such a good opportunity for Auntie Anne's is, as a franchisor, entrepreneurs are not good. Entrepreneurs do not make good franchisees because they have all their own crazy ideas. And as a franchisor, you don't want people to have all their own ideas. You build a model and you stick to the model. Middle managers were good because they were very good at accepting instructions and implementing them. A lot of them lost their jobs. Along with that came, you know, multi-year buyouts for many of them. So they were capitalized. And so I think a lot of the success of our early growth came out of that middle manager group that was reasonably capitalized to open these stores. My point is, a lot of them were scared because they had never been out on their own. And a part of my job was to help build their confidence. I look back and I can't even tell you how much I worked because I don't remember. I didn't think about it then. It was just what needed to be done. But it's different today. You know, people are more aware of work-life balance and things like that, that I don't really know what that means. Sounds nice, but it's not always effective. And, you know, at the time that the company needs something, if you're there, it'll be, you'll create more opportunity for yourself. So. Yes?
Hello, my name is Tristan, and I'm a first-year officer as well. I've heard the quote, "What we do defines us," a lot. I've heard that relates to business a lot. What would you say your biggest defining moment was in your career?
I go back to my dream big, work hard, and never quit. There were two points in my career at Auntie Anne's where I almost quit. Something didn't feel fair, or the pressure was just, you know, too much, and it wasn't work pressure. You know, it was somebody else in the company, and I remember as clearly as if it were yesterday, going home and talking to Melody, saying, "You know what? I don't know if I can do this anymore. I mean, it's just, you know, it's just taking too much out of me." And that's why I talk about fortitude. I will tell you my escape at that point. We had 5 acres that we lived on in Southern Strasburg Township. There's this big meadow out in the back, and at night it was completely quiet and completely dark, and the stars were just incredibly bright. And I would go out there probably one evening, one night, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 9:30 after the kids were asleep, with a big fat cigar, and I'd sit out there thinking. And I think that's where I built my fortitude back. And I only say that is that had I quit, I would have missed out on the biggest opportunity of my life, and that was acquiring the company, continuing to build it, sell it, reinvest those proceeds into a business that has created 500 jobs and an incredible amount of economic activity. So I think never quitting was really, at a couple of points, the defining point in my career. Yeah. Did I see your hand was up?
I'm Danielle Zahn. I'm an international business student. I'm a sophomore. Going from like owning a food company to having a sports complex, like how did you go from one to the other? Like you said you wanted to just open a couple courts for volleyball, but it became something a lot bigger. How did that work?
At Auntie Anne's, we had developed, I mean, we didn't develop it. I think we borrowed it from somewhere else and kind of made it work, you know, for us at Auntie Anne's. But it was a threefold philosophy. had to do with customer service, cleanliness, and the product. And I think that applies no matter what you're selling or what you're doing. And so as I didn't say this earlier, but our daughter Monica was played club volleyball for 4 or 5 years. And so the reason I even knew about these tournaments is that we went to them all the time. But you know, we'd go, and a lot of places were opened by someone who just had a passion for the sport, but not much business background. And so you'd have these just, you know, big dust balls in the corner. You know, just cleaning wasn't important, volleyball was. And you know, equipment that was stacked all over the place, not really organized, and the floor, the playing surfaces were often worn out, you know, and just didn't get replaced. And so I started making the connections between that threefold philosophy at a pretzel store and what should a good sports facility look like. And so I think, you know, that was the crossover. At the end of the day, we have 21 business units within Spooky Nook. So, you know, from a P&L perspective, we've got 21 different little businesses that run in there. So when you look at something that, you know, of that enormity, and then you break it down into 21 pieces, it becomes manageable. And then you just begin applying the, you know, the right business principles, and it's not that different. Yes? I would say probably the two biggest risks was one when I sold the little business I had and joined Auntie Anne's. And the reason was we were on a comfortable path to where we wanted to go, we being Melody and I. And this, you know, Auntie Anne's was undercapitalized and understaffed, and you know, there was a lot of good things happening, but there were also a lot of people didn't think it would work. And so that was a, you know, probably one of the biggest risks. And the next one is no doubt opening Spooky Nook Sports. And I'll tell you, most of my financial advisors said, "Are you nuts?" Because I took a large majority of the proceeds from selling Auntie Anne's and reinvested it into a new business that was unknown, unproven, and turns out to be quite challenging. But I will tell you that, you know, I can't wait to get up in the morning and go to work and figure out how to do something a little bit better. And so it, you know, that risk is what keeps me alive or awake, I guess, is a better way to look at it. It's a great question. Yes?
Hi, my name is Maxwell Redden. The thing that really stuck out to me is the whole fortitude thing, and my wrestling coach said that to me when I started wrestling. Having, he called it intestinal fortitude, so just going with your gut and just pretty much doing what you need to do. But another thing that interests me was you really took that philosophy from Auntie Anne's Pretzels and used it to give back to the community. So would you say the motto and everything when you worked at Auntie Anne's was, had a really positive impact on your career up to this point where you opened up Spooky Nook?
Yeah, there's no doubt. There are probably 100 more points that I could spend an hour talking about each of them, and one of them was that, you know, as I had the opportunity to take on more responsibility at Auntie Anne's, my constant focus was on how to serve and take care of those people around me. Even when I became president, my goal was not, okay, now I've arrived, you guys take care of me. Because you see, what happens is I took care of the franchisees, as I served them, and as I served the other managers in the company and all of the employees throughout the company, no matter what my position, I ended up with a large group of people around me that wanted me to succeed because they truly believed I was there to help them succeed. And it's the opposite of what a lot of people, I don't know if they believe, but it is the opposite of what they practice, which is, I'm going to take care of myself first. And then if there's something left, I'll take care of someone else. And you turn that on its head without being naive. I'm not naive. I can hold my own. But when you serve others first, it's amazing what comes to you in terms of benefit. Yes?
You said you lost, my name's Ryan, by the way. You
said you lost $40,000 at a company you started when you were 21 years old. If you could go back for any ants, what would you have done differently to make that company more successful?
Probably nothing, because I'd be stuck there. You know, the loss of that money, to me, that was my tuition. And boy, did I learn. I learned about contract law. I learned about leases. I learned about the honesty or dishonesty of people that sit across the table. Those were principles then that I could apply for a long period of time. I mean, the simple question is, I don't ever want to lose 40 grand. But that set me back to a point where I really had to start over. Pridefulness was not a problem. I had my butt kicked. And when I met my wife, I'm telling you, our first date, I took her out in that stupid truck. It caused me to focus on what I think what was really important. And so I don't think I would want it different. You know, Scott.
One more thing.
Sorry.
You said a million people have come in this calendar year. Is that 2017?
Yes.
That's impressive.
Yeah. Thanks. Oh, I'm sorry. No. Wait. What year is this? No, it was November of 2016. So,
okay.
In those 10 and a half months. No, not this month. Oh boy, I'd probably. Let's see. I don't know what I'd be doing if we had a million this month. But yeah, it's good. Yeah, it is. Scott.
I'm Scott Johnson. I'm a first year business administration student. You said earlier a lot of your experience at Annie Ann's helped you with the transition to Spooky Nook. What's one thing or a couple things that you weren't so prepared for? And you don't feel any ends kind of like set you up for, and what did you do to kind of combat that or learn from that?
So I think there are two things that are pretty simple to outline. Number one is at Auntie Anne's, I had somewhere between 100 and 200 customers, our franchisees. They dealt with all the people at the counter. So I call, at Auntie Anne's, the franchisees were our customer. The people that purchased the pretzel were the consumers. And our customer dealt with all of those consumers. At the Nook, I come face to face with a million people pretty fast. And that was a big adjustment because you had to deal with everything from the towser out in the bathroom to, you know, I didn't like your parking today. That was, I think, probably one of the first or one of the biggest realizations. The second is the number of employees. At Auntie Anne's, we were more we had more corporate employees, and at the Nook, I probably have 300 employees that are in food service, housekeeping, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a different type of employee that I've really grown to know. Well, look, I think the number one thing is don't wait, all right? The younger you are, not being married is better. If you're married, not having kids is better. Because each one of those incredibly cool milestones in your life add another element of responsibility. And when you're starting, when you're at a startup, you've really got to sell out. You know, some startups, you know, I guess people get lucky or whatever, but you know what, you read story after story, and when you, a startup, you got to sell out. You got to sell out in terms of time, in terms of your financial commitment, in terms of the clarity of focus, and so the earlier is better. And if you fail, you can recover. You know, when you're young, you can recover. If you're 55 and your retirement's already set and you do a startup and it takes away a nest egg, you know, it's a lot harder to recover at that point. Yes?
I'm Dylan. I'm a Beth International Business student. So part of your story reminded me actually of Milton Hershey, which you probably know failed four times before he succeeded with his candy. So I was wondering if you thought that maybe initial failure is like a key point to being successful later in life.
Well, look, I think, back to fortitude, and we parents mean well. But we make a huge mistake when we don't let our kids fail at a young age. And all right, so I'm gonna just go a little bit. All right, participation trophies are the worst thing in the world. There are winners and there are losers. And the sooner you acknowledge that and embrace it, the sooner you have a better shot at becoming a winner. And as a winner, I don't mean, you know, if you lose a baseball game as a person, you're now a loser. I'm just talking about work or sports or whatever it is. And I got so nervous about answering this question, I forget what your question was. Yeah, it is. It absolutely is, because it's painful. And there's nothing like pain to make an impression on you. I think that the problem is that we've probably so personalized failing that we get it confused with who we are instead of what has happened. And so I think failure is I learned a lot from it. So I think you can choose to learn a lot from it, or you can be defeated by it. And that's where I say, dream big, work hard, and never quit. If you dream big, it doesn't matter really how hard you work, you're gonna fail sometime or another. And then if you quit, you just lost out on the value of that lesson. Okay, yes, sir.
We'll do two more questions, and then we'll get our lunch group together.
My wife and I have been taking D-Town students to foreign countries for 25 years, and we always enjoy going to India. Pretzels at all these airports like Bangkok, Thailand. So we just spent the past year in Saigon, Vietnam, and we were startled to find an Indian's downtown, good location. And we kept going by, and there was never any traffic, so we started seeing all these little girls outside with the trays, and they were doing their darndest to draw people in. So we'd bring our students over there when we were in town, and they loved it, a little piece of Lancaster and exotic land. So this past year, we were going there. I'm talking about summer 15. And then we went back to try it. My wife loves pretzels, and I started eating the cinnamon sugar little bits that they were offering. And it was a completely different diet. So we were startled when we went back in the summer before we left town, and it was gone. You know, the sign was down, the place was shuttered. So my question to you is, we were wondering if that fit the diet in Asian culture. And number two, how much failure rate did you have with your franchisees in foreign countries?
Throughout my involvement at Auntie Anne's, we had a pretty low failure rate. So we tried to open in Israel. That didn't work. Japan, the first effort didn't work. We were very careful in terms of trying to open in those countries. We were as careful as we were in evaluating locations here domestically. To open a store that didn't work means that we missed out on something that should have helped us understand. In the Asian cultures that we opened, Thailand was by far the most successful. Malaysia was right behind it. Indonesia was very good. Why? We never did, at least as long as I was there, quite come to understand what's the difference. I mean, in a lot of cases, I think it was the licensee. So it was that local person who knew how to translate the product to an acceptable expectation in that area. I will tell you that probably one of the reasons that I was able to finance the acquisition of Auntie Anne's was that one of our lead bankers went to Malaysia for a business meeting. I can't remember what it was. This was a big deal at Bank of Lancaster County. I mean, it was a growing bank, but it wasn't a huge bank by any means. And he got off the plane after this long flight to Malaysia, and he was on an escalator going up toward baggage claim, and about halfway up he goes, "No way." And you come up to the top of the of the escalator, and here's this giant Auntie Anne's store, and there was a line of people there, and I'm convinced he came back thinking, this thing can work anywhere in the world. We're crazy if we don't finance it. So it was that was just another international story.
Okay, last question.
I can't say there was. That mean, you know, if there's 100 franchisees, it doesn't mean that two weren't really unhappy. But because of the process that we engaged in, which involved them, them being the franchisees, our customer, you know, at the end it was a pretty smooth process. And I think, you know, why it was a smooth process is they understood what I was undertaking. They understood the cost to undertake that. And they recognized that the price increases we were implementing were not exorbitant. They were necessary to support, you know, the new business plan or model. And so, you know, at the end, it was a reasonably well accepted process. 1% is what we increased the royalty. So to most franchisees, that was going to equate to another $5,000 a year in cost. So it wasn't insignificant. It was a, you know, pretty big deal. Good. Hey, I enjoyed talking with you. Thanks for your questions. Appreciate your time.